Hey, Helen here, your host. Great to have you along for the second season of The Beautiful Side of Grief, where we continue to hear from people from all walks of life who have faced or have been involved with heart-wrenching loss and who've come out the other side with so many positives to share with others. I know this may seem like an impossibility for you right here, right now, to be in that space. And believe me, I understand. I lost my own gorgeous 18-year-old daughter and only child in a car accident. Yet, here I am 4 years later, sharing my own journey and those of others in the most heartwarming and joyful way. Each and every one of my guests share their own beautiful insights and their strategies for getting through their grief. And through these stories, I hope you'll find your own way to deal with your grief in whatever form that may take. I'll pop my guest links and any free resources in the episode notes, along with my website address if you'd like to know more about the energy work I do, as that was my lifesaver in my own grief journey. Don't forget to subscribe and like so you can keep informed of each weekly episode. So now let's see who our guest is this week. My guest today, Michele Benyo, is a mum of two, a certified grief recovery specialist, an early childhood parent coach, and the founder of Good Grief Parenting. After her six-year-old son died of cancer, her three-year-old daughter said, "Mummy, half of me is gone." This heartbreaking statement defined Michele's life purpose. Her mission is twofold: to help parents through the unimaginable challenges of parenting while grieving the death of a child, and to help parents meet the unique needs of a child who has lost a sibling in the early childhood years. The desire of Michele's heart is to see families live forward after loss toward a future bright with possibilities and even joy. If you have experienced child loss, you know that this can be different from other forms of grief. And this is not to negate or minimize other forms of loss. It's just different. Child loss can leave you beyond devastated with no hope for the future and in a darkness that can be hard to escape. As difficult as it is for parents, it also has a profound effect on siblings left behind or the friends of those who have died. So this is such an important topic for us to be exploring today. So thank you for listening in, and may your own journey be filled with love, light, and hope. So Michele, I am beyond excited to be connecting with you today and to be speaking with you on this subject.
Thank you, Helen. I'm really happy to be here too. I just look forward to our conversation. It, like you say, it is just so important.
Yeah, and already I know that you're going to bring so much valuable information, just what we were talking about in our, you know, pre-recording chat. So yes, here's my excitement. So I mentioned in the intro that your six-year-old son died of cancer. You know, firstly, my absolute condolences on your loss. And are you able to share with our listeners your journey with your son through his cancer? And then, you know, around his loss.
Mm-hmm. Yes. Thank you, Helen. Yes. Well, I thought that I had, just to go back to the beginning, I thought I had the perfect family. You know, I always wanted a daughter and I had a son, but it took me about 2 seconds to recognize what a blessing he was, of course. I mean, what parent wouldn't? But he was tender-hearted and beautiful. And eventually, I had my daughter. So I had a big brother and a little sister. And that was just, to me, the perfect family. We knew we were only going to have the two children. And so this was perfect. And he was 4 and a half when he was outside playing in the winter, when he, you know, had a lot of clothes on and he was kind of sticking his hands in the front of his pants and he kind of kept doing something. And I called him to the door and said, "Honey, what are you doing?" And he said, "I'm feeling these bumps." And that was how our whole journey started. He had some lymph nodes in his little groin that were protruding through his skin. And we investigated, you know, over the course of several days. The doctor thought it was an infection. We, you know, treated him for an infection. It made no difference. And it was actually his dad who examined him thoroughly one evening and found that between his legs was as hard as a rock.
Wow.
And he had a grapefruit-sized tumor in his perineal area. It wasn't protruding out. It was all inside, but it was there and hard. And that was when we learned that our son had cancer.
Oh, how heartbreaking. What is your son's name?
Yes.
Let's give this beautiful boy a name.
Yes. His name is David. His beautiful little sister's name is Deanna. And so we had been a family of four, a close family of four. And the first night that David went to the hospital to stay overnight, his dad went with him. And I was home. Deanna, who at the time, David was 4 and a half, she was 15 months old. And when he was at the hospital that night, she started wailing. She made this inhuman sound that I've never heard anyone make before or since. And it was really alarming to me. And she wandered up to the room and pulled me downstairs to the garage door. She was just despondent. And when I would try to comfort her, she'd throw herself on the floor and push me away and just wail. And I was not a broken mess. I was pretty, you know, I was doing okay. It wasn't that I was being hysterical or had in any way, but she had been there through our discovery. She had picked up on what was going on in our family. She heard, you know, phone calls. She saw us crying, and then her brother and her dad were gone, and she was just beside herself.
Michele, can I interrupt for a moment? Because mm-hmm. I think this is such an important point that you're drawing on, mm-hmm. that what children notice, even from a very, very young age, and sometimes we can think it's better off not including them in the journey or not to include them in what's happening. But I know you feel differently about mm-hmm. that. So I know as you go through the rest of your story, that's going to come out, but mm-hmm. really mm-hmm. wanted to just draw that out.
Yes. And the other thing is that after I had my son, I had previously been an educator, actually a high school teacher, but I was kind of an educator at heart, but I had gone into communications instead. But then after I had my son, I learned about a program that every school district here in Minnesota has in the school district, and it's early childhood parent education. And when I learned about that, when I was a new parent with a young child, I thought, oh, I want to do that. So I had, when I was pregnant with Deanna, I had gone back to graduate school, gotten my licensure to be an early childhood parent educator. And I graduated just before she was born. So at the time that this was happening to our family, I was a brand new early childhood parent educator. So my whole orientation with my kids was what's going on with them. And so, you know, I of course, really paid attention to her and just saw every cell of her body was feeling her loss in that moment. And we spent the next 2.5 years going through this grief journey with David until he died at the age of just 2 months shy of his 7th birthday. But what we decided, and I, you know, she showed me right then and there that first evening, we said, you know, she is on this journey 100%. This is impacting her as much as it's impacting any of us. And we are not going to leave her. We lived in a cul-de-sac. We had wonderful neighbors. I had a sister who lived in town. And we said, you know what? We're not leaving her with any of those loving people who could care for her. She's going to be with us. So for the 2.5 years, it was really the four of us going through this. Our son was at a children's hospital. And this was, I should say, this was 20 years ago, so this little bunny has now grown up, and back then, siblings could be there. She could be with him a lot, and he was at a children's hospital where they had wonderful things for siblings and, you know, took care of siblings, so siblings were certainly welcome there. But we did notice that a lot of families didn't bring their other children. They didn't want them exposed to that. You know, all of the little children with their bald heads and their bandages on their chests where their ports were and tubes coming out of their noses and pulling their, you know, transfusion poles with them and all of this. But we said, this is her life as much as it's our life. And we just exposed her to all of it and she was fine. She was able to be with her brother. She, you know, it was, she'd get on with him on his bed and raise the bed up as high as it would go. And she'd sleep in the sleeping chair by his bed. And, you know, he died when she was 3 and a half. And, you know, as you said in the intro, when he died, she said, "Mommy, half of me is gone." And as heartbreaking as that was, and it was, I mean, that was the hardest part, the absolute hardest part. As hard as it was for me to lose my son, it's been harder for me all of these years that she hasn't had her brother. But at the same time, she had much more of him in those 3 and a half years and the ability to just have that relationship with him that she wouldn't have been able to have nearly to that extent if we had not allowed her to be part of what we were all going through.
Yeah, I think that's such an important thing to raise because, you know, she clearly had a really strong bond with David. And,
yes,
you know, like you say, as unsettling as it is seeing all the, you know, side effects and all the different treatments that children go through, you know, kids are resilient. They're far more resilient than what we give them credit for. So they're actually able to handle that extremely well. And I think kudos to you for having the wonderful insight to include her on this journey so that, you know, she had a rich, full 2.5 years with him, you know, that will probably have helped her through the rest of her life.
Oh, for sure. For sure. And, you know, the work that I do now really is based on what I learned about young children going through something like this, number one, and number two, the power and the ongoing impact of that sibling bond. Those are just really the two things I learned from her that, and I'm so grateful that I had started doing the work I was doing, because obviously that made me pay attention to things that I may not otherwise. If I had been my own typical self pre, you know, getting my master's in family education and studying early childhood development that way, I wouldn't have had all of the insights that I have. And I say the same thing to Deanna now. She's 25 now. And I say, I wish I knew when you were 3 and 4 and 5 in those young ages, everything that I now have to share with parents, because I also didn't have all of what I know now when she was going through it. I was learning it along with her. And so now I'm sharing things with parents that I sometimes learned a little later than I wanted to.
The beautiful thing is that you're sharing it nonetheless.
Yes. That's
such an important thing. But it is often our own experiences that lay the foundation for these life purposes that we go on, you know, this journey that we go on. And often, you know, I think we have inklings along the way, but we're not quite sure of what the big picture is until suddenly it hits us right in the face. We have no choice but to follow where our heart is taking us. And for you, your life purpose was then to help other people, other parents understand this journey. So how long after you lost David did you decide, or did you know that this was your purpose?
I really knew it right away, partly because, and it's evolved over the years to where I am now, and I'm able to do what I'm doing now because I have completely gotten through raising my daughter, and now I can look at other people's journey a little bit more closely without hearkening back to mine. I, you know, as I was going through those years with her, recognizing the layers of that onion of early childhood sibling loss that were, you know, unpeeled throughout her life. Now I'm at the point where I can present it back to others. But at the time I knew, because my thought was, okay, my child has said half of her is gone. She's got her whole lifetime ahead of her. This is not okay. I'm not going to let her grow up half gone. She can't grow up that way. How am I going to help this? What am I going to do about this? And I thought I would have kind of an advantage because I was in the area I was in, and I thought, I know how to find resources. And so I looked and I didn't find any. There weren't books out there. There weren't people out there. I found a quote at the time, and just to let your listeners and you know how I fit into this grief journey piece, I was looking for something other than what was available to me, because Children's Hospital had some wonderful support groups. There were support groups even for my daughter, and they were wonderful. But there's a quote by an author named Anne Royfe, who wrote a book after her husband died. And she said, there are two parts to grief. The first part is loss, and the second part is the remaking of life. What I wanted help with was, how do I remake the life of this child who had what I looked at as a perfect life, and now her brother's gone and there is absolutely no way to recover this, you know, to reconcile this. And so I needed help remaking life, and there was nothing out there. How do you parent a child who, you know, has this loss and now has to live forward in the presence of grief? Because I think that's the thing that people grapple with too, is where does grief start and end? And it really doesn't end. But that's not a life sentence. That's not a, you know, that just means your life is going to be different. And if you want to live without grief, it's not possible. So I had this 3.5-year-old with half of her gone. Her life was ahead of her. I had to remake it. I had to figure out how, and I didn't know how. So I knew that if it didn't exist, I was going to have to do it. I thought, I'm an educator. I'm going to figure this out. There are going to be other people like me who need help. I'm going to help them. But it took me until my daughter was launched in her life for me to say, okay, now I'm going to establish good grief parenting, and I'm going to put into a framework that I can help others with a way to tackle this. And it isn't by any means intended to be the way. It's just so many of the things I learned, mostly things that help parents trust their own wisdom.
Let's just stop there for a moment, because you've brought out some really, really good information. Hey, I love good grief parenting as a name for your organization. That is so positive. And how lucky Deanna is to have had a mom who was so aware of what she needed. I also want to explore, because when you go through having a sick child, particularly a young child, there is so much wrapped around you throughout that whole journey. You have lots of support, you know, through the illness and things like that. But I often feel that, you know, when they lose that battle and when they finally depart, there's this big, huge, gaping hole and gap where you go from such intensity to looking after them and managing everything, to suddenly having nothing to do to fill your day, to fill that void.
Your umbrella's gone. Oh, absolutely. The umbrella was gone. The umbrella of the Children's Hospital, with all of their support, not only of David, but of us and of Deanna. And just the knowing of what we were going through. And yes, one of the things, because I work with parents, not the child, but with the parent, and one of the things that I recognize that I never had, I did meet some moms at the hospital. I did know some other moms, but they weren't in my, you know, weren't nearby. We didn't establish this ongoing connection with one another. Back then, in the beginning, Facebook wasn't there. And so, you know, we didn't have some of those things. So community with other parents is so vital. And I find that's one of the most gratifying things that I find with the families that I work with. And so far, it's been moms that I've worked with, where they just, sometimes we have questions. And you know this because you're a mom who lost a child. Sometimes we have questions and we don't know if we're right or wrong. We don't know if we're on target or not. We've never been through this before. And I felt like there was a right way to grieve. I'd never really had any big loss. So this was my first grief, really, of any kind. I'd lost a grandmother and a beloved aunt, but they hadn't been really present in my life. And I didn't grieve it like this. I mean, this was totally different. And so one of the things that I really want to bring to families is this community where you can ask these questions, and then just this understanding that any question you're asking, I can guarantee pretty much that my response to you is going to be, that's exactly okay. That's exactly the way you're supposed to be experiencing this. Yeah. There isn't just one way to do it, but other people who don't know any better try to tell us, don't you think it's time that you start being happy again? Don't you think it's time that you start? And with me, I had a woman once tell me, out of the goodness of her heart, out of her best intentions, that she thought maybe I talked about David too much and that Deanna, that probably wasn't good for Deanna. And I knew she was wrong, so that didn't bother me. It didn't make me second guess, but it does make some parents second guess themselves. And
I love,
yeah,
because that happens way too much. And actually, I talk nonstop about my daughter. She was my life. She still is my life. And there's no getting around.
Yes.
And I just say that's other people's problem.
Yeah.
I don't want to hear that I had a daughter who I love beyond.
Yeah.
And I think it's very therapeutic to be able to share your life that you had with
them,
share their name and talk about them. And because I hear of people who have lost a sibling and that sibling has never been spoken about again.
Oh, and that's heartbreaking.
Oh,
yes. And we can blame Freud for that, because all of these people who tell us to move on, which is such a common thing to say to a griever, that's really based a lot on his theory, where the purpose of grief was to get over and beyond the relationship. Now, thankfully, we have some newer ideas about grief, and there's one that I include in my Good Grief Parenting Framework as one of the four heartbeats or pillars, and it's continuing bonds. And that's the idea that really one of the best things we can do in grief is find healthy ways to continue the bond with our loved one. Because grief is love, love with no place else to go. And when we've had a loved one, our relationship with them doesn't end just because they died. We still love them. So with continuing bonds, we can find ways to carry them forward. And with Deanna, when she would go to a new school, some kids knew her. She went to the same preschool he'd been at. They knew him. But as she got into school where they didn't know him, I would say she had a brother named David. He died of cancer. We talk about him. She will talk about him. You will talk about him with her if she talks about him. I had to normalize the fact that she she was still a sibling. That's the big question for children too. Well, and she had no other siblings. Am I still a sibling? Yes, you are, honey. You'll always be a sibling. You just don't have your brother here. That's a really difficult way to grow up.
That's an awkward question for mm-hmm. a lot of people to answer. I mean, even as a parent, mm-hmm. how many children do you have? Mm-hmm. And like for me, you know, even like the other day, I was on the phone to someone and they said, you know, do you have any children?
Yeah.
Not any longer, but I did have.
Yes.
So, but it just kind of catches you unawares sometimes. Mm-hmm. And you have to actually, like you say, normalize these types of things for yourself so that you can know how to answer them, know how to deal with them and know that situation. And just to go back to something that you just mentioned earlier about grief never ending, I know that for myself in the weekend, I was, you know, busy writing out a post and that. And I actually ended up, because I'm doing interviews with Tal's friends, you know, impact of them around her loss. So I'm going to do that shortly. So I was setting up the interviews. And so I was going back through a lot of memories. Honestly, I was just crying the whole time. And I was just emotionally left as a desert. And but that wasn't a bad thing. You know, like I said to people, yes, I'm crying, but don't take that crying as a bad thing, because for me, it's just remembering all the things that I had forgotten or hadn't been remembering. And I don't do it often, but yes, and that's the key to it, is that there's good grief and there's not so good grief. And what we want to focus on and what you're focusing on is a good grief. So let's go through what it is that parents are letting you know that they most need from you.
Well, one of the things that I've discovered, and it has a lot to do with many of the things you and I have already talked about, and I just became so keenly aware of how important this is as I started working with other bereaved families, and that is the idea of permission. Like this, like remembering your child when someone says, because if you look at Facebook groups, I'm in several Facebook groups, and there's periodically someone who is not knowing what to do because their family is accusing them of wallowing and telling them to take the pictures down and put the things away. And they don't know if they should or not. And so it's this idea of permission.
Yeah.
You have permission to grieve the way that you need to grieve. Not only is it okay to keep reminders of your loved one there, but it's beneficial to you, it's healing to you, and you not only do you have permission to do it, but you have permission to tell other people, I'm sorry, this is what I want to do, this is what I'm going to do, and not feel like you have to justify it, because you are totally okay to make decisions for yourself. You have permission to say to them, what you're saying, that isn't helpful at all. This is what I need to do. This is what I'm going to do. Thank you. I know you're trying to help me, but I don't need, you know, your comment isn't helpful. And that is so empowering for grievers, because we so often feel like we have to justify ourselves to other people. And so we end up kind of doing it without recognizing that we're totally in the right, and that whatever we want to do, we can tell those people, this is what I'm going to do, and I'm not listening to you, and please don't tell me otherwise. So permission is huge.
You just touched on a way of saying that, which I think people are unaware of sometimes, because they get angry, you know, that people
yes.
aren't understanding where they're at or what they're wanting. And you said a beautiful thing. You just said, thank you. And, you know, and I think this allows you, by saying that, you know, those two words, thank you, that you allow yourself to let go of any sort of anger or whatever it is. You're acknowledging what the other person is saying. And it allows you to say, thank you, you know, for your thoughts around that. However, you know, this is how I would like to manage this. And it allows you to do it in a strong and empowering way. And that's
right. Yeah. Without the anger, because yes, it is so easy to get angry. I've been in some interviews where people have asked me what my advice is to people who want to support a griever. And I say, well, that's kind of a tricky question because I'm, again, in Facebook groups, people will express their opinion and they'll say, somebody said this to me and it made me so mad. And other people will say, yes. And I look at it and think, well, that wouldn't really make me mad. One thing is when someone says, I'm sorry about your loss, that really annoys some grievers. And yeah. I'm not sure what else someone should say, number one. And number two, yes, I know they're not responsible, but they are sorry. That I don't have a problem with it. So when someone asked me what's the right thing to say, you know, I can't say, don't say I'm sorry, because if you said that to me, I wouldn't take offense. But it really just is about, you know, being a listener, a listening ear, and being comforting, a caring presence. And for the griever, then it is, like you say, for them to just recognize that they can let go of any anger because the person who's saying this to them doesn't know what to say. And they don't understand. And that's frustrating. But it's not their fault they don't understand. And
absolutely,
yeah,
such a key thing, because mm-hmm. people get upset with these people, and I think just give them grace, because mm-hmm. the fact that they're trying to share with you that they feel your hurt and sorrow and things right. like that is the key thing. They may not have the right words or the mm-hmm. right actions, mm-hmm. but they are trying the best they can.
And so that's a, you know, an answer to your question. That's a conversation we get into in so many forums, is just, you know, recognizing the people that say the wrong thing or the people who go away. And I think that's why the community with people who understand what we're going through is so important. And as you say, being able to let go of it. And we did talk in one of my groups, we talked about, okay, you decide what, like you suggested, Helen, what you're going to say in this situation so that it doesn't take you by surprise, and so that you kind of disconnect from the feelings that it would bring up in you otherwise, and just decide how you're going to respond, and then deliver that response with peace, you know, and let it roll off your back, because we carry enough pain with our grief, and we don't need to carry pain because other people aren't giving us what we need, because they really so often just can't.
Yeah. So you decided to focus on this younger group of children.
Yes.
The parents of this younger group of children. Was that because of your early childhood background?
Yes, it really was, because as an early childhood parent educator, I just really see those years as so powerful. And I mean, you know, the first 5 years of life are when the brain develops and creates the pathways that, and more research just demonstrates how much those early years impact the rest of our lives, our physical health, as well as our mental health. And so, and I have met adults who were those young children whose parents suffered a loss of their sibling and never were able to come to terms with it and never able to give this child the support they needed. And they grew up as adults not having the, you know, the emotional support they needed. And so I really want parents of young children for whom it's so easy to overlook what the young pre-verbal child is going through. If my daughter had not said to me, "Mommy, half of me is gone," I would not have recognized her as being as deep as it was, because they don't grieve the way we do. They grieve inside. They watch us. And if we're upset, a lot of times she was as good as gold, because she knew that her dad and I were going through enough. And so she didn't cry. She didn't, you know, see, she tried to behave and be good and not do anything to upset us. And so it would have been really easy to assume that she was doing fine. And she really, children really do need support. They're not going to show their grief. And many adults say, well, they look like they're doing okay. Well, that doesn't mean they are. And they really do need our help. You mentioned earlier that kids are resilient, and they are, but they need our help to build that resilience. They don't, you know, they bounce back well. They're kind of made that way, and it's amazing, but they need our help in these times.
Yeah, they need good boundaries, don't they? I worked on a program for four-year-olds for many years, and those we had a project that we were doing a lot of research into, which was the first 1,000 days and the impact of those first 1,000 days on a child's life. And it helped us by the time they reached four to understand what they did, or more importantly, what they didn't get in those first 1,000 days, which was going to impact on their future, you know, because we've done longitudinal studies that shows, like, even simple things like speech, having a hearing issue and like that. Well, for 60% of our male population in prison, and I'm digressing here, back to having a hearing problem when they were very, very young, that was never picked up, never dealt with until it was too late. And by then they disengage. So, yes, the impact on young children in those first 3 years is so, so vital and so important.
And just establishing, just excuse me, Helen, but just establishing the way of dealing with things. And that's why the remaking of life is everything that I do. I start with making sure that families are sort of oriented to the fact that grief is not something that we need to avoid. We need to face it head on. We have a lot of ideas about grief that make it harder to grieve, like the things, don't talk about this person too much. And some of those things that a lot of people try to tell us that are not helpful. So I try to get parents on that same page with what is okay for them to do with grief, which is whatever you're doing really is okay. You're okay, even if you're not like everybody else. But then when I get into more of the parenting pieces, it really is parenting that is appropriate for every young child, not just the grieving child. And it is about learning ways to deal with emotions and naming emotions and all of those things that, because when a child experiences something traumatic like a loss, they experience feelings they don't know how to name and deal with. And the other thing that I say is that not only is it okay to expose these really young children to loss when it appears in their life, but it's really the best time, because early childhood is what it is, which is that it's the time of life where our foundation is laid down, the way that we deal with emotions, that's all established in those early years. And if we can learn, if a child can grapple with loss and grief and have parents who can help them do that when they're very young, they're going to have loss and grief throughout their life, but they've learned at a young age to manage it. Unlike many of us who are adults, you know, I didn't learn as a child how to deal with grief, you know. But my daughter did.
We're going to talk about embracing grief. But just before we do that, there is something else that you just mentioned.
Sorry, I kind of overruled you
there. No, I love what you're saying. And it's just bringing out so many more things I want to ask you. So do you find that parents, when they're coming to you, are first having to deal with their own issues, with their, you know, that track way back? Because what I think grief does is it highlights, it has this way of highlighting all the aspects of ourselves that we perhaps haven't got balanced and that are out of sync. So sometimes in order to help your children, first you need to understand what's going on for you and help yourself with perhaps unresolved emotions and traumas from your own past. Would that be a fair comment, or do you find that or not?
That may be true, but that sounds more like therapy. And I'm a parenting coach. So if someone really had deep-seated issues that they needed professional help with before they could get to this, they would do that elsewhere. But what I do start with is the ideas around grief, which make grieving hard. There are a lot of myths, and I got my certification through the Grief Recovery Institute, and they identify, you know, 6 specific myths. There are more, but there are some that they've identified that really help us stay stuck in grief. And it's things like, I'm just going to stay busy so I don't have to think about it. Or if, you know, if we suffer a loss, we do something to replace it. Or, you know, some of the things we do with children, we don't want them to grieve. So we just say, oh, let's go do this fun thing and make them forget about it. There are just a lot of things we do with grief because we learned it, because our parents did it, our grandparents did it. Many people around us do it. The way we respond to grief isn't helpful, because most of those ways we respond to grief do not involve just facing it and going through it. And that's truly where the healing is by facing it and going through it and allowing ourselves to feel what it's a human experience that is part of the way God made us, is to grieve a loss. So grief is a response to any loss or significant change that you don't want to see in your life. And so it's normal and natural, and ignoring it doesn't help it at all, doesn't make it go away. So I do start there with families, just helping them see what they have believed about grief that maybe needs to be adjusted. And that's the first, I mentioned the 4 heartbeats. The first heartbeat of my framework is good grief beliefs, where we tackle what's really true about grief and change our beliefs. And so, I was going to say something else, but I lost my train of thought. So yeah,
that's okay. So go through the other 4 heartbeats.
Oh, okay. The first one, and I know what I was going to say. I was going to say the other thing that I do in the beginning with families, with parents, is help them deal with self-care. That is the first piece. And maybe that's sort of what you were asking about as well. So it's really the good grief beliefs. And with that, the self-care. They need to take care of the most important thing that any parent can do for their child at a time like this is to take care of themselves so that they can be the best parent to their child, and their child sees them dealing with what they're going through, because we're role models for our children. And it's really important for us to feel like we have the reserves to help ourselves and to help our children. So that's what I was going to say. So the first heartbeat is the good grief beliefs. And the second one is that continuing bonds that I mentioned earlier. And then the third, and in the good grief, in the course that I have called See Your Way Forward After Child Loss, we go into other relationships as well, such as, you know, 2 parents in a family where a child's died. The 2 parents are going to respond differently, and sometimes there are tensions there and difficulties there. And that's, again, where that idea of permission comes in, is, you know, we really want to continue strong bonds in all of our good relationships, all of our important relationships. That theory applies to the one that's died, but it's also true with the ones that we're still living with. So that's part of the second heartbeat. And the third one is essential messages, which is those things that as a parent, we need to make sure we're giving to our child, the messages that they need from us. Like, you know, yes, I'm really sad your child, I'm really sad your brother died, but I'm so happy you're here. I love you. You are so important to me. There was an author, Betty Davies, who wrote a book that I believe is no longer in print, called Shadows in the Sun, about sibling loss. And she talks about some of the messages that children, that living siblings can get. Things like, I'm not enough because the parent is missing the other child so much, or I don't understand any of this because the parent's not talking to the living child. So this essential messages piece is about all of the communicating both verbally and non-verbally and in the choices we make and the behaviors in our family that we do to make that child feel like they are valued and validated and deeply loved and cherished. And so that gets into the parenting piece. How do we help kids deal with emotions that are frustrating for us? And, you know, a lot of those things are things that every parent of an early childhood age, 2 and 3 and 4 year old, deals with.
Yes.
Yeah. And there are some better ways and less good ways to, you know, to help the child understand what's going on with them. So that's the essential messages piece. And then the last heartbeat is what I call choice actions, which is now that you know about good grief beliefs and continuing bonds and essential messages, which is all this head stuff that now you've got, how are you going to raise your family and live forward? Because it's just like those, like you were saying, and like I was saying, we acquire so much from our own upbringing. And when we're parents, we're going to default to that. And I know for me, I needed to change my defaults because I didn't want to treat my daughter and my son when he was still living the way that I was treated. There was a lot I wanted to do differently. So I had to make some very intentional choice actions based on those other three heartbeats that I bought into and really wanted to carry forward in my family. So that's the framework of the good grief parenting.
That is such amazing advice, and what an incredible framework. And I just love that the heartbeats. Oh,
yeah.
That kind of just really resonates with me.
Well, and that's what I want it to do. The whole point of good grief parenting is that you have your own heart wisdom. You know, if we as a parent tap into how we feel about our living child as well as our deceased child, you're going to be a good parent. And so it's a lot about helping you be that good parent and giving you guidance and giving you permission.
How soon do you find it is that parents are engaging with you to go through this process? Is it quite early on in their grief, or is it left a little bit until they can get through the worst of it and then start to get their head back into gear again?
It's really both. And I didn't know. I was really not sure what to expect. I knew that I wanted this right away, but I also knew that I kind of wasn't typical because of my background and my perspective and everything. And so I wasn't sure. And I have had some people come to me within just a few short months of losing their child. And it's been extremely valuable to them. And I've had some parents come to me 2, 2.5 years later, and it's been extremely valuable to them as well. So I've decided that, you know, I try to talk to people who are considering joining my course, which, you know, a person could sign up for it without talking to me, but I prefer they talk to me. And I try to find out if they're ready to focus on their child. Not exclusively, of course, but I did have one mom, when I was talking to her, say to me, frankly, I'm just not ready to think about what my child needs right now. And that's, yeah, you may not be. So you need to just grapple with your, you know, your loss, and you need to take care of you, and you do have to do that first. And so it really is them being self-selecting. But the main thing is that they can focus on their child and be able to take those needs to heart. Not that they're going to do it every minute of every day, but a lot of what we grapple with is that balance. I'm grieving, I'm parenting. How do I do them both at the same time? Because they're equally demanding.
So, yeah, such a good point to raise and draw out on, because that's it. You know, you're coping and grappling with your own grief.
Right.
And you've got these other children who are also needing you. And how do you balance that also? Mm-hmm. That's so, so good. In our New Zealand Māori tikanga, we have the introduction of children right from the get-go to death. You know, like when anybody dies, whether it's an auntie or uncle or grandparent, people always all gather on the marae, and the body is there, and children learn to play around it, and it just becomes second nature. Like they don't even think about it. And I think that is something that we don't do in our Western cultures. We don't embrace death in such the same way. But it's like what we talked about earlier, which is what I wanted to draw on, is that, you know, we need to encourage our children to understand and embrace death from a very young age. So it just becomes part of their life, and they know how to deal with it and handle it. And the earlier, the better. So it's to be embraced, not avoided. And then you also talk about continuing bonds. So let's just go explore that as well.
Well, you know, I also do some trainings of childcare providers, and I have a training I do for them called Teachable Moments, Grief in the Early Childhood Setting. And it's really helping them as care providers. And, you know, I say the same thing to parents. We don't need to wait until our child has experienced a traumatic loss. We can teach young children about death and loss and grief. There are countless ways to do it throughout the day throughout the days, whether it's they find, you know, a dead little bird at the bottom of a nest. Or for me, I tell this story when I talk about the grief that we experience as children. And one thing that I do with families is say, you know, do you remember the first time that you experienced grief? And I remember the first time I experienced grief, and it's interesting because I have an older sister, and I mentioned this to her the other day, and she said, "Oh, I remember when that happened to you." And I thought, oh, you know, that kind of validated, not that I necessarily needed it, but it kind of validated the fact that it really was a traumatic experience for me, because it was when I was at the beach when I was probably 5 or 6 years old. And I lived on Lake of the Woods in northern Minnesota. So the lake goes on forever and ever, and it's just water out to the horizon and beyond. And I had this blow up riding toy named Wally the Walrus. And I fell off of him, and he scooted away from me, and the wind took him out. And none of the adults who could swim could get him. Nobody could get him. And we just I had to stand on the beach and watch him and I could watch him forever float, 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 float off to the horizon. And I, to this day, I remember how I felt. And it was just awful because I was never going to have it. I mean, I lost something that mattered to me as a young child. And I was there's no way I'm ever, ever going to get it back. That's grief. And what parents typically do in a situation, or what mine did and, you know, typically do in a case like that, is try to make the child feel better and say, oh, it's just a toy. And, oh, you know, go play with this. You like, you know, whatever they say. And we need to start recognizing, as Mark Twain says, Mark Twain has a quote that says something like, a child's loss of a doll and a king's loss of a crown are griefs of the same. He's talking about grief, and he says they're the same. And so, yes. And so as adults, we really need to recognize that when a child experiences a change or a loss, which is what they respond to with grief, that we honor that. I talk about honoring grief. And if parents can do that with losses that children experience, no matter how insignificant, you know, if that had happened to me as an adult, no, I wouldn't have grieved it. I would have been sorry to see it go, but I wouldn't have grieved it. But as a child, I grieved it. And so those grief, you know, those instances of loss and grief are different. And we need to help kids understand, oh, it's so hard to watch your toy float away. You were having so much fun with it. I'm so sorry you aren't going to be able to play with that anymore. You know, just honoring the feeling. Yeah. And then, you know, remembering the things that made a child feel. You talked about the continuing bonds piece, and we can do that, you know, if we see the bird and we talk about the bird that we found in the yard. at some point in the future, if something happens, we can say, remember when we found that bird and we felt so bad about that bird? You know, it's just kind of making it all normal and a natural part of living in life, and helping kids know when they feel that way, that it's normal. I felt this way before. I went on, I'll get past it. And then, of course, we have griefs and losses that, you know, aren't as easy to get past as a bird falling out of a nest. But by that time, we're, you know, we just learn as we grow. And so there are many ways in the early childhood setting. There are good books about lifetimes, you know, something is born, it lives, and it dies. And there are ways to talk about death. I say use the words with children so that they, because there isn't any, I mean, death and dead mean something. They have a real specific meaning that other words don't have. And so if we want children to learn about death and dying, we want to use those words because they're, we don't like the words. We have a stigma, if you want to call it that, around them. But to the child, to the child, just it's another vocabulary word that they're learning. And they're, and yes, you know, at the age of two, they don't understand what death is. I would say one advantage to Deanna's time spent with her brother and with us and with our conversations, and because we knew David was going to die. When he died, his cancer came back for the third time, and they had done absolutely, after when it relapsed the first time, we did everything. And when it came back again, there was nothing more to do. We knew he was going to die, and we talked about that. And so when he died, she never did ask when he was coming back. She was only 3 and a half, but she did understand the permanence of it. And kids will, you know, they maybe don't know when you give them the word, but a few years later, they will know, oh, you know, this is death, and nobody comes back from death. And so those are the things that I think as we think about how to help our children with grief and with that continuing awareness, that continuing bond around it, these are some of the things that I would say.
It's about putting everything into context, isn't it? And those were great analogies with, you know, the animals and Wally the walrus. And, because it helps people understand. And I spoke to somebody the other day who said, just imagine if nobody or anything died on our planet. Just imagine the chaos. So it is. It's a natural part of life that we have to realize and appreciate. Well, we've had the most wonderful, incredible discussion, and I could just keep on talking to you because I feel like we've only just touched on things. But, you know, let's finish up with a quick question. So I want to know what the best thing is that's happened to you either today or in this past week.
Oh, my. You know, I think the best thing that's happened to me is the point that I'm at in my life right now where I'm doing this work and I want to be doing more of it. I want to be in touch with more families, which is why I really welcome the opportunity to be on podcasts and just to talk. I loved our conversation. Thank you so much. It was delightful to talk with you. I'm recognizing that I'm at this point of trying to, you know, get more traction. And I am feeling every day when I get up, and this is the best thing because I'm recognizing that I just recognize how I'm prevailing and how I'm every day starting with a positive attitude. And I would say that much of my life without my son, most of my life, I've been able to be positive. It was the mantle I put on. There's so much we haven't talked about how the early days, the things that gave me encouragement and the things that helped me know that there was a plan for me to move forward, and I was able to just go forward with it. And sitting here today, recognizing that I was able to do that and that I'm still doing that. That's the best answer I can give, is recognizing in the morning that I'm prevailing and that I'm prevailing with positivity.
Maybe we can, share all that information in another podcast, because like I said, I've still got questions.
Oh, otherwise. Yes. They're just layers and layers of our lives.
It's such good information. And so, yes, let's continue to explore it. And thank you for that beautiful comment on being with me on this podcast. That fills my heart. Mm. What is your proudest moment to date?
It's not just one moment, it's a couple moments, but it is the moments when my daughter tells me, and sometimes she's written me notes, when she says, "You were the best mom and you were exactly the mom I needed," because she tells me that a lot. And parenting her, wasn't easy. It wasn't cut and dried. It wasn't easy. But that's the most important thing I've ever done, is raise her to adulthood. And I know I made mistakes, and yet she doesn't see my mistakes. She sees that she has the mom. She always says, "I'm so glad you're my mom." That makes me proud.
I wish parents could understand this, because we're often so hard on ourselves about our parenting skills, and we always think we could be and should be better than what we actually are. But for our kids, it's often the simple, most special, precious moments that carry them through anything that we do wrong, really.
Right.
And it's the same. Like, as a single parent, I struggled parenting the strong, feisty, sassy child I had. Mm-hmm. But, we grew up to be the best of mates, and I'm so proud. So, just quickly share with us how Deanna's doing now.
Deanna is strong. When people say, "Who's the person you admire the most?" she is who comes to mind. Beautiful. She is very much her own person, which of course was a challenge for me. But at the same time, she has such a good head on her shoulders that she hasn't ever made a decision that I was troubled by. She doesn't have the confidence I wish she had in, going out and job seeking and some of that. But the person she is so empathetic. She's really perceptive of other people's feelings. And this is what one of the benefits that research shows of children who have lost a sibling, or a sibling in particular, I suppose probably other losses too, but that they really learn, because they've had this experience, they learn to really empathize with other people who are having a hard time. And she gives people the benefit of the doubt when I think, I wouldn't be that gentle. She's just really a genuinely good person and a good friend. And
beautiful. Mm-hmm. Oh, wow. That is so special. That's precious. Okay. When you have moments during your day that turn to custard, that's an expression we have here, how do you pivot yourself out of those into forward thinking again?
I don't know, but I just do. And I am a believer in God, in Jesus. That is a huge part of my journey. And I have, from the time I was a young girl, felt like God preserved me in certain situations. And I feel like he's just given me a good, I'm tenacious. That's a word I used to describe myself. The first time someone described me that way, I didn't know what it meant. And I went and looked it up. And ever since then, I thought, yes, I'm tenacious. To me, it is not an option to be in a funk. I mean, I can go there and then I'll say, okay, you could stay here a little while, but you're not going to stay here long. And I don't. And I get myself out of it, because it's just not an option for me to stay there. That's just really I give myself permission. I think with all of us, I think the more helpful response for other people is, when we go to that place, you know, it's okay to be there for a while. You don't have to get out of it right away. If you go there, there's a reason, and you probably kind of need to be there for a while. Just don't let yourself wallow there, you know?
Beautiful. I love that. Oh, yes. Okay. And what would you like to leave our listeners with? What takeaways would you like to leave our listeners with?
You know, one thing that, well, there are four takeaways that I usually leave parents with for their children. And some of them I've mentioned and some of them I haven't. But one is to, you know, the first one is to take care of yourself first and don't put that aside. Don't put that off. That's important. Another one is to have conversations with your children. And this is the one we didn't talk about a lot, except to say, use those accurate words. But don't be afraid to talk to your child about the feelings that you have, that others have. Ask them how they feel. So, you know, be willing to have conversations. The third one is that continuing bonds. Make sure that you find ways to maintain that connection. And the fourth one that, you know, that I give parents is that honoring grief piece. And so those are really, and this isn't that difficult to do. I guess that's the main takeaway is I think when parents recognize that their own instincts are often really pretty good and that there are some of these things that they, you know, you don't have to be afraid of talking to your child. You don't have to be afraid of facing grief. You don't have to put away your loved one who died. Take care of yourself. I mean, those are really pretty easy things to do, and they will make a huge difference. So those are my takeaways.
Those are gold nuggets, and there's freedom in that. Exactly.
Yes.
And in that last sentence, such freedom. It's allowing people to be what they need to be.
Yes.
Yes, absolutely beautiful. Michele, oh, what an incredible conversation
Helen. Yes.
Just been filled with so much really valuable information that I hope our listeners and those parents who have suffered the loss of a child can really take to heart.
Yes.
How can people find you if they're wanting to explore what you're doing more?
Well, I hope that they will. I am at Good Grief Parenting, and I just really want to encourage and lift up any families who need that encouragement to see your way forward and recognize bright possibilities. At my website, you find some resources, in particular on the very first page, my Good Grief Guide, which is available for any adult who wants to help children with loss, not just child loss. And then there are some other resources on my website, but that is the best place to get in touch with me. You can reach out to me through it. goodgriefparenting.com.
Wonderful. And thank you. That is a free resource, the
yes.
Good Grief Guide. And so I will have, as always, all the links in the episode notes so that you can easily go and find how to connect with Michele. Michele, absolute pleasure having you
today
on The Beautiful Side of Grief.
For me too, Helen. Thank you so much.
You're welcome.
Hey, thanks for listening. If you enjoyed this episode today, be sure to share it with others. Hit the subscribe or like button so you can be notified of each weekly episode. Also, let me know how I'm doing, especially if there's more you'd like to know that perhaps we didn't get time to touch on today or in past episodes. And if you're after resources to help you out on this journey, or more about the energy healing work I do, hit the Healing to Be You link. That's the word healing, number 2, letter B, letter U.com. So until next time, be kind to you, and thank you for joining us on the beautiful side of grief.